Joining us now from Exchange in Miami, we have Hamish Preston with S&P Dow Jones Indices and Nick Kalivas with Invesco. Well, Nick and Hamish, it's great to have both of you with us today.
Thanks for having us.
So starting with you, Hamish, what is the S&P 500 equal weight, and what are some of the key characteristics of the index?
Sure. So the S&P 500 equal weight index was launched in January of 2003. As the name suggests, it equally weights the component companies in the S&P 500 on a quarterly basis. Now, one consequence of that, which is really important, is that the equal weight index has less exposure to the largest names in the S&P 500 compared to its float market cap counterpart. So for example, whereas the largest five companies in the S&P 500 account for about 24% of the index at the end of 2023, those same companies account for 10% of equal weight. You know, other tilts that equal weight has are tilts towards value and away from momentum. And from a GIC sector exposure perspective, equal weight simply tilts away from information technology.
And following up with Dave Hamish, how long have the S&P 500 equal weight indexes exposures that you mentioned informed its relative performance over different horizons?
Sure. So although the index was launched in 2003, we actually have data going back to the 1970s for equal weight. Now, even if you look at that back-tested period, so 1970 to 2003, or indeed since in the live history, equal weight has outperformed over time, but crucially not all the time. Now, if you look at the relative performance, the smaller size exposure I mentioned was crucial, accounting for more than 50% of equal weight relative returns over that over those two periods, but also tilts away from momentum also important. Now, the other thing that was quite interesting, actually, is although you might think, oh, they tilts away from information technology, that could be very helpful at different points of time. That certainly was the case in the tech bubble, and over the last couple of years has been important. But actually, if you look at the relative performance, it was the impact of equal weighting within each sector that was very important in equal weight's relative performance. So what that means in a nutshell is the equally weighting of each component within each sector typically accounts for a hefty portion of equal weight's relative performance.
And turning to you now, Nick, why might investors want to consider the S&P 500 equal weight index in the current environment?
Yeah, so there's a couple of reasons why that equal weight might be a very good solution. I think, first of all, for investors who are worried about the growth drift in the S&P 500 cap-weighted index, they can use equal weight to mitigate that risk. If you look at the Morningstar style box right now, you'll see the cap-weighted S&P 500 is kind of up in that mega cap leaning growth box. And in fact, you see a large overlap to the NASDAQ 100, which is known as a very growthy index. That overlaps about 45% now. If you roll back 10 years, it was around 20%. In addition to that, there's a large valuation gap that has developed between the cap weight and the equal weight indexes. It's about a 20% premium cap weight to equal weight. And historically, that gap or that premium is closer to just 1%. So investors who are valuation conscious might want to think about using equal weight to mitigate some of the valuation risk which is present.
And following up with you, Nick, Invesco has strategies that combine sector exposure with an equal weight approach. What should investors consider when using equal weight at the sector level?
Sure. So I think, first of all, think about concentration. If you look at Apple and Microsoft at the end of last year, they were almost 50% of the IT sector, really big weight. And you'll see that repeated in things like consumer discretionary. So for investors who want more economic exposure, want exposure to the broader sector, you know, they're thinking about expanding profit growth or some type of theme in the sector or even M&A, equal weight can be a very good way of capturing the opportunity in the sector.
Sure. And lastly, Nick, could you talk about the growth of the S&P 500 equal weight ecosystem and what that could mean for market participants?
Yeah, so it's kind of been growing over time. I mean, if you think about it in terms of product, the first equal weight mutual fund was kind of launched in the mid to late 70s. Then you had the ETF in 2003. You saw the sectors come about after that. And looking forward, actually, to see he's going to launch a futures contract on that. So there's really a lot of opportunities to use the equal weight concept for the broader market, for the sectors, maybe in a retirement account or a mutual fund. And now with the futures, I think you're just going to see more kind of trading and investing opportunities in that broader ecosystem.
Well, Nick and Hamish, it was great to have both of you with us.
It's an honor. Thanks for having us.
And thank you to everyone watching. Once again, we're here at Exchange in Miami, and I was joined by Hamish Preston with S&P Dow Jones Indices and Nick Kalivas with Invesco. I'm Jenna Dagenhart with Asset TV.